sure that your cell phone is off or on silent. Please stand singing praise to you, O Christ our Savior.
Glory to you. began to complain, saying, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." So to them Jesus addressed this parable. A man had two sons. The younger son said to his father, "Father, give me the share of your estate that should come to me." So the father divided the property between them. After a few days, the younger son collected all his belongings and set off to a distant country. He squandered his inheritance, life of dissipation. When he had freely spent everything, severe famine struck that country. He found himself in dire need. So he hired himself out, one of the local citizens, and sent him to his farm to tend his swine. He longed to eat his fill of the pods which his swine fed, but nobody gave him any. Coming to his senses, he thought, "How many of my father's hired workers have more than enough food to eat? But here am I dying. Get up and go to my father, and I shall say to you, 'Father, I sinned against heaven and against you. No longer deserve to be called your son. Treat me as you treat one of your hired workers.'" So he got up and went back to his father. While he was still a long way off, his father caught sight of him. He was filled with compassion. Ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. His son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven, against you. No longer deserve to be called your son." But his father ordered his servants, "Quickly, bring the finest robe and put it on him. Ring from his finger and sandals on his feet. Take the fat calf and slaughter it. Then let us celebrate with a feast, because this son of mine is dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found." Then the celebration began. Now the older son had been out in the field, and on his way back, as he neared the house, he heard the sound of music and dancing. He called one of the servants and asked what this meant. The servant said to him, "Your brother has returned. Father has slaughtered the fat calf, because he has him back and saved himself." He became angry. When he refused to enter the house, his father came out to him, pleading. He said to his father, "Look, all these years I served you. Not once did I disobey your order. Yet you never gave me even a young goat to feast on with my friends. But when your son returns, you swallowed up the property of prostitutes. For him, you slaughtered the fat man." He said to him, "My son, you are here with me always. Everything I have is yours. Now we must celebrate and rejoice. Because your brother is dead. Come to life. He was lost and has been found." Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes, you're the parishioners in the boats, able to make it out of this wet. But good to be back with you for the mission. Begin with prayer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the gift of this evening. We give you thanks for bringing us into existence, for giving us the gift of life, for giving us the gift of faith, the gift of knowing your Son Jesus, having salvation in and through him. Thank you for the rest of this evening, for the opportunity to stop and pause and ponder, to know your infinite love for each one of us. thank you especially for the gift of Jesus this evening, present to us, most blessed sacrament of all. Love here for us. We ask the Father, the Son, to send your Holy Spirit upon us this night. Come, Holy Spirit, come with us. Open our hearts and minds. Help us to know all, desire us to know, to receive all that we wish to be. Come, Holy Spirit, powerful procession of the Blessed Virgin. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women. Blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Father, and Son, and Holy Spirit. It's good to be back and sharing your bread and sacrament moments ago. How nice it was to be here to celebrate two of the Masses, to preach all of the Masses, to be here with the community that came on Sunday to worship the Lord, to give thanks to God. Beautiful to see the life that's here at St. Jerome's. Powerful witness, as I said, at the Masses on God these days. Usually I'm in the office quite often, so nice to be out and have a full weekend in the parish and to see life of faith that's yours to be edified and built up on. You recall we're in the process these two nights of remembering. I had said when we gathered the weekend that time of mission, time of coming together as a community, focusing on the Lord and His Word in our lives, is about remembering. It's getting back to the basics. And the basics that I put forth at the weekend were about two questions. Why we need Lent. Who it is that we move towards during Lent. Who it is that invites us deeper into Lent. And better said, who it is that waits for us at Easter, at the end of Lent. I'm not sure if those of you Sunday morning Mass and went out for waffles afterwards. Relayed that story of my brother and my nephew and all the Masses. People seem to have waffles on their mind at the end. It's a humorous story about a brother getting smeared syrup, but as I said, there's a point to it, a helpful point for us who desire to ask these questions about why we need Lent, who it is that waits for us. As I counted a little nephew in that moment of picking up a waffle with all the syrup on it, innocent as he was in doing it, reminds each of us that at times we make a bit of a mess with culpability, unlike him. We sin, we don't live as we want. And that's why we need Lent, said the Lord. And my brother, in his goodness, that evening at the airport, with his patience and understanding, his kindness and compassion, reminding us, giving us a beautiful image of the Father, God, the one who invites us into this, one who desires us, one who is longing for us, patient with us as we find our steps along. As I said at the weekend, my desire was to simply go through this most beautiful parable of our Lord from St. Luke's Gospel, and through it to delve a little more deeply into these questions. Parable, as we said, of the prodigal son, as it's most famously known, but as the scholars tell us, it can be called by different names. Parable of the merciful father, the one who's there to reap the wayward son upon his return, the prodigal when he comes back, and to the older brother who's out in the field, who comes back with anger in his heart. The father was merciful, loving towards both of his children. So the prodigal son, the merciful father, and finally the parable of the two brothers. Pope Benedict has some beautiful commentary on this parable in preach especially in some homilies that he gave when this was scripture for the day. Pope Benedict says that he thinks calling the parable of the two brothers is probably best, because the beginning verses of chapter 15 here in St. Luke sets the scene. There are tax collectors and sinners on one side, Pharisees and scribes on the other. Two different people. Some who have gone astray, perhaps. Others who are caught up in their righteousness. And looking at both, Jesus gives us the power. Man had two sons, he says. So, the two brothers, the parable of the two brothers, according to Pope Benedict and some scholars, a fitting way to turn to the parable. But whatever we call it, a masterpiece of the Lord, one which opens up so many different places within our hearts, gives us so many places to plumb. So good for us to be with it tonight and again tomorrow. Before we enter into the parable, most especially tonight, to look at that question of why it is that we Lent, who it is that we are, how it is that we mess things up. Before we look at those questions, we contemplate the two brothers this evening. Very simply, a reminder of the most basics of what we are. As we said the other day, we came to the church on Ash Wednesday. The church gives us ministers two ways in which you can be signed. You can be signed with ashes. That first, repent and believe in the gospel. The second, remember you are dust, and to dust you shall return. And holding on to that, seconds about being dust and remembering where we go. It opens up for us this evening a good place to begin. And that's the reality of our existence. Not something that we may ponder too often. You know, it's a stark thing here on Ash Wednesday. No one walks around the street saying that I'm dust and unto dust I shall return. When it strikes us, it is something that gets to the core. We can't shake it because we know the truth. It is who we are. What does it open up for us? Well, the simple fact that we're created, that none of us has control over the weather. If someone does, maybe has the rain to stop, my ride home, they don't have a seatbelt. None of us has the power within ourselves control the elements, to bring things into existence out of nothing. None of us can use the philosophical languages, unmoved. None of us are first cause. Each and every one of us created, beautiful, thankful, by God, in love, through love, for love. Each of us are dependent. None of us are self-sufficient. No matter how good we get through the day, no matter how it is that we're able to get things done, ultimately we're all dependent. That's that reality, dustiness, we might say, of us. And there's nothing to fear in it, because it is all from the Lord, from the one who made us. Those without God find that incredibly disturbing. But for us to know God and the truth of our story, to know how it is that we came to be, why it is that we're here, to move towards Him, grow in love with Him, then that creatureliness that's ours, that dependence, is not something to be afraid of. When we hone in on it, it opens up something, again, important here in the beginning. You might call it a poverty that's ours. Maybe that's ours. Each of us are finite, but each of us, because we're made by God, given intellect and will, given a soul, given a desire for Him, each of us has a longing for something more. this is the piece of music. We're overwhelmed. We can't take it all in. We can't describe it. It's every part of us. Or we simply are in our backyard and watch the sun go down or the bird fall off. Something that strikes us and that provokes within us this beautiful response that He's made us for something wonderful. He's made us ultimately for Himself. These little things that come along remind us of that. That I can never satisfy myself by going around doing things, but I must always be satisfied by another. Music, the beauty of the scene, time spent together, friendship, joy, meal, all of those things remind us of something more. That we are not complete in ourselves, that we have this poverty, that we have this ache for Him. That's the truth of who we are. Again, that we're made creatures, that we're dependent, that we're not self-sufficient, that we're made for something great, we're made for God Himself. Union with Him, communion with Him, life forever with Him. But here now is the journey. On this earth, the ache is there, the poverty is there, the longing. Because of that, again, remembering who we are this night, there is a drama that we live in our lives. You might say my life's not too dramatic. At this point, I pretty much have my routine down, know it well, not a lot of drama here. But each and every one of us, the very fact that we are created, the very fact that we are dependent, the very fact that we have this ache within us, this beautiful longing for more, each of us lives a dramatic life. There is, we might say, constantly the tension within us. Tension as we choose how it is that this poverty, this need that we have, this longing that we have is fulfilled. The most beautiful moments, we acknowledge our neediness. We acknowledge that the longing is only fulfilled with the Lord Himself. When I turn to Him in prayer, when I remember His presence in my life, when my life finds its order and its rhythm in Him, then there's the beauty. But if you're like me, you don't always live. That's how life can become a bit dramatic. When we choose not the Lord, not His plan, when we fail to acknowledge our neediness and our poverty, but rather we choose, in a sense, ourselves over Him. Sometimes in a general way, very specific. We choose our own plans, our own projects, our own ideas. Lord, I feel push, I feel the way that you want me to move in this direction, but I want to be here. I know you're calling me to be present to these people at this moment, but I'd so much rather just pull back into my own little plans for the evening. It's much more enjoyable. Me, right? There's always the tension, always the having to choose. Following Him so the ache and the longing is fulfilled, we as creatures are needed with the Creator who made us, or choosing ourselves. That's the drama of life. We are creatures, daughters and sons of the Father, who can either live in relationship with Him and progress and move and grow grace to grace, become changed. Become, use the language of the East, divinized, to become more like God. Or we can just do our own thing. But we know where that gets us. So remember that we're dust, and unto dust we shall return, but fear not, is the one who made us good, made us for Himself. And in the innate longing for Him, choose Him or choose yourself.
remind us of the two basic ways that we go our own way. And in seeing this, we see why it is that we have to enter into Lent, take on the disciplines of prayer, fasting, and honesty, to step away from ourselves, towards the Lord, the only one who will fulfill this ache, this longing in our heart. So, the younger son, prodigal son, Pope Benedict, as I said, writes beautifully on the parable. And he talks about the younger son who lived on this farm of his father, and who lived a very ordered and disciplined life. The Pope says we can imagine the way it went. Good farmers that they were, they woke up early in the day before the sun. Being good Jews, they would say their prayers at set times in the course of the day. They would have their meals at set times in the course of the day. And the young son grew up in this environment. He continually was in it. But there came a point when he said, you know what, there must be something else. I realize in my heart a desire for more, but I don't know if it's going to be found here. In living according to these rules, in living in this ordered, rhythmic life, better that I go out and find it by myself. The Pope, in one of his homilies, Pope Benedict, was preaching to in Rome, in prison for young people, I guess juvenile delinquents. And Pope Benedict is beautiful. I love his homilies, I love his writings. They're so rich, they're so clear. The tradition of the church, the liturgical life of the church, always in them. And accessible, incredibly accessible. But this particular homily, for someone who was a professor, brilliant, really accessible to young people, almost hear him speaking to them, attentive to them. And I love the language he uses. He says, to the son who lived his life, lived his rhythm, was getting bored with it, decided that he wanted to set out, the Pope says, on his own life project. Very current, he said. You know what, there has to be more. Let me go out, fill this cave myself. Let me have my own project. Life here may be just a little bit too boring for me. I'll go out and find my home. So, the Pope says, he goes to the Father, as we know, as the parable tells us, and he says, Father, give me my inheritance now. Let's pretend that you're dead. Let's pretend that you don't exist. You know what's going to happen after you die? Let's let that happen in this moment. So, split your property, give me my name. We know the Father is good, aware, and his wisdom what's going to happen, respects the freedom of the Son, and generously gives him his inheritance. So, the Son's freedom having been respected, he sets out on his own project. The language of the parable is beautiful in that it tells us that the Son went off to a far country. The Pope, with others throughout the church's tradition, tells us that that means two things. Literally, he went somewhere far away. I don't know, here. Not much has happened around here. This is where I've grown up. I hear it's a lot better down the road. So he sets off and he goes far away. But the Pope says, the tradition of the church tells us that it also seems like a distance in his heart. That he's going far away from what had been familiar to him, far away from the routine of his life, from the discipline that he had, from following those rules that kept life together and gave it order. He goes far away. Interestingly, the Pope comments, Pope Benedict saying that you can almost imagine it being good for a few months. He had all his money in his pocket. He's far away from having to get up early and work hard. And spend his money on food he wants, buy some drinks for his friends. It's all good. But then it starts to go a little sour. The money dries up. No one's there to help him. And he has to confess. confront an emptiness that's returned. Be disturbed by it. This ache, this longing that I had in my heart that I thought I was going to fulfill, find satisfaction for by going out and living a life that's far from the life that my father wanted. All of a sudden, I realize that it's not as full as I thought. That once again, I'm empty. The Pope uses a pretty strong word. He says he got caught up, the son who wanted to be free, and being a slave, doing the things he didn't want to do. Some, you know, move to that beautiful, powerful moment of conversion of coming to his senses. But we can see a path here, this way in which the ache, longing, his desire to connect by doing things my own way. By having my own project, my own plan, by thinking that I know better, casting off the wisdom of the Father, by moving away from rules and the rhythm of life, taking things upon my own. All of us can relate to this younger brother, younger son. We all know the ways that we think we know best at times. We know ways, perhaps dramatically, in our life where we've chosen this and literally have gone far away from a place of comfort, a place of familiarity, a place of love. Enter into relationships or places or patterns that have been ultimately somewhat destructive in our lives and that have not been satisfied. It is a story, of course, a parable that is so powerful because it resonates with us. We see the truth in it. It opens up for us that powerful reality that we have a longing not satisfied ourselves. The one who made us can. His ways can. His commandments, life with him, all of that can. Even here and now, even in the steps that we take day in and day out, we can begin to find satisfaction and fulfillment. A foretaste, he said, of what's to come. That's that younger son, a little juicier maybe than the older son, the older brother. But turn to him now just for a moment. The one who stayed, like the scribes and the Pharisees, the start of the parable, the one who was righteous. The father asks me to rise at 6, I get up at 5:30. He asks me to work all day, I put in an extra 10 minutes. I do what I'm told to do, and I'll even do a little bit more. I do it dutifully, because I'm told to do it. And if you look at my duty, if you look at the fact that I've done it, then that should be enough for you. Don't look into my heart. Don't ask what I think of my father who asks these things of me. That's between me and myself. I'll mutter under my breath, and I'll bemoan the fact I'm here, living this life, but I check every box, and all those are. The son, the older brother, can live this way, can be perhaps deceiving of others, thinking that in some way, the ache, the longing, will be satisfied. If I just keep doing it this way, if I just do what I'm told to do, at some point, there'll be a bomb in my heart, and all will be well. But then, something sparks, and the heart is laid bare. The son who was dead has returned. The son who was lost is now found. The one who was dead is now alive, brought back to life. And the father is overjoyed. The son returns to know, hears the music, the dancing, and is angry when the servant tells him what has happened. All the duty,
places where you shouldn't have gone. The older son, the older brother, spending his life without love, without charity. Both not satisfying the Lord, not filling up their hearts. Again, just as the younger son resonates with us, so too, I imagine, the older brother. All of us in our ways, thanks be to God and grace, are able to be dutiful at times. We do the things that we're supposed to do. But there are moments when charity and love is not there. They get it done from the outside, thanks be to God. They do. And we can maybe even get a good example of doing this. But we know within there's a resentment, perhaps, an envy that what others have. And that we simply are stuck in this place of pouring ourselves out, wondering if anybody notices, wondering if we'll ever change. So the masterful parable of the Lord bringing forth these two brothers, these two sons, and us resonating with both. We who are his creatures, who are dependent, who are poor, needy, and who have this longing for something more in life, fulfilled only by God. We see these two. We who long realize that, yes, we fall at times in both places. That we set out from the rules of the Master, the rules of the Father, and try to do it on our own. And there are these instances when we do it all, but we do it without it. And if we're before both of those things, how clear it becomes why it is that we need these four things. As I said, at the weekend, we can go on autopilot of Lent. Just get caught up in doing what we've done before. And maybe bringing it down to that seeming common denominator of fasting, of giving something up. But the Lord wants a whole lot more from us. He wants a relationship. The Father we can hear about tomorrow, who has shown himself to us even this night. The Father wants a relationship with us, with his children. For that to happen, we have to be a place where we come to our senses. Lent invites us to look upon ourselves, to see the neediness, to see the ways that the hate and the longing is there. And unfulfilled in our own ways, invites us to turn to him. So before the Lord this night, before Jesus on the altar, we ask for that grace. To be able to boldly, courageously, to stare into our life, to look into our heart, and to see the ways that we need to turn to him, and find the longing, the ache, the desire, fulfilled in what we need. We ask Jesus that you be with us tonight, that you fill our hearts, give us courage, wisdom, that we help us to be bold, looking within, to turn away from all, keep us from you, so that we can come to our senses like the younger son. Set back to the Father, wait patiently for us. Blessed be God.
Blessed be His name.
Blessed be Jesus Christ.
Blessed be the name
of Jesus.
Blessed be the most sacred heart of God.
Blessed be the most precious blood.
Blessed be Jesus, the most sacred and holy of God.
Blessed be the Holy Spirit, the power of
God. Blessed be the Holy Spirit, the power of God.
Blessed be the Holy Spirit, the
power of God.
At every moment, in all the tabernacles in the world, even to the end.